أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
Hazrat Khalifatul Masih the Fifth, may Allah be his helper, stated, "Today I will mention some expeditions from the time of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. In this regard, the mischief of the tribe of Banu Asad and the expedition of Abu Salama will be discussed first. Assyria refers to an expedition in which the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, did not participate personally, but sent others on missions. Even these shed light on the life of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, on his wisdom, how he defended the Muslims, and how sympathetic he was towards the enemy. These expeditions shed light on all these aspects of his life as well. In any case, this expedition took place in Muharram in the fourth year after Hijrah. And it was led by Hazrat Abu Salama bin Abdul Asad Makhzumi. Abu Salama's name was Abdullah, and his filial appellation was Abu Salama. His mother was Barrah bint Abdul Muttalib, who was the paternal cousin of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And the foster brother of Hazrat Hamza, may Allah be pleased with him. He was suckled by the maid of Abu Lahab, Thuwaiba. The mother of believers, Ummi Salama, was previously married to him. Hazrat Abu Salama participated in the battles of Badr and Uhud. He was wounded during the battle of Uhud and was being treated for a month. The wound had apparently healed to such an extent that no one could recognize it. The backdrop to this expedition is as follows. The hypocrites and Jews that lived in Medina started celebrating due to the outcome and circumstances of the Battle of Uhud. Once again, the thoughts entered their hearts that they could soon start scheming to eradicate the Muslims. Similarly, the tribes that lived in the surroundings of Medina, who had become fearful due to the magnificent victory of the Muslims during the Battle of Badr, started harboring these thoughts as well, that the Muslims have suffered great losses during the Battle of Uhud. As such, this is an opportunity to attack the Muslims and cause them even greater losses and acquire their wealth and belongings by looting them. Hence, only 2 months had passed following the Battle of Uhud that these tribes started scheming to attack the Muslims. And the first tribe to do so was that of Banu Asad bin Khuzaymah. This tribe lived in Najd. The leader of this tribe, Tulayha bin Khuwaylid, and his brother Salama bin Khuwaylid gathered people together and formed an army. An individual from Banu Asad, Qais bin Harith bin Umayr, advises people not to attack the Muslims and said, "Oh, my people, this is not wise. We have not suffered any loss at the hands of the Muslims. They are not causing us any harm. Nor have they attacked us to loot our belongings. Our location is far from Yathrib, i.e. it is far from Medina. And we do not have any army like the Quraysh either. Even the Quraysh sought help against them from the people of Arabia. They wanted to seek revenge and set out on their camels and took hold of the reins of their horses. They were 3,000 soldiers and had a large following with them and also had a lot of weaponry. What are you in comparison to this? You will set out with hardly 300 individuals. As such, you will deceive yourselves. You will be far removed from your home, and I fear that you will fall into difficulties. However, they rejected the advice of Qais. The news of Banu Asad's plots to attack Medina reached the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, when a person from the Banu Tayyib tribe named Walid bin Zuhair came to Medina. He had come to meet his niece Zainab, wife of Tulayb bin Umar bin Wahab. He informed about these plans of the Banu Asad tribe. And so the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, decided that prior to the Banu Asad tribe attacking Medina, the Muslims would, for their own security, launch an attack in their area. Thus, he called Hazrat Abu Salama bin Abdul Asad and instructed him, "Go forth on this mission. I have appointed you to oversee this." Thereafter, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, tied the banner for him and instructed him, "Continue on your journey until you reach the lands of Banu Asad, before they are able to assemble their army to confront you. Once you reach there, launch an attack on them." He sent an army of 150 companions under the command of Abu Salama to reprimand those tribes. The person from the Banu Tayyib tribe, i.e. Walid bin Zuhair, also escorted them as a guide and to show the way. Some of the names of the companions who participated in this expedition are Abu Sabra bin Abi Ruhm, Abdullah bin Suhail bin Amr, Abdullah bin Makhrama Amri, Mu'attib bin Fadl, Arkam bin Abi Arkam, Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah, Suhail bin Bayda, Usaid bin Hudayr Ansari, Abbad bin Bishr Ansari, Abu Naila Ansari, Abu Abd, Qatada bin Nu'man, Nadr bin Harith, Abu Qatada Ansari, Abu Iyash Suraqi, Abdullah bin Zayd Ansari, Khubayb bin Yasaf, Sa'ad bin Abi Waqqas, Abu Hudhaifa bin Utbah, and Salim Mawla Abi Hudhaifa. In order to maintain the secrecy of this mission, the companions went swiftly and not via the ordinary route, so that they could reach the enemy as quickly as possible. They journeyed for consecutive days and nights. According to one narration, they would hide away for a part of the day and then travel at night. In this manner, they reached close to Qatan mountain after 4 days. In relation to Qatan, it is written that this is the name of a mountain near Faid, and Faid is the name of a destination en route to Kufa, where the spring of Banu Asad bin Khuzaima was located. Having reached there, the Muslims immediately launched an attack, seizing their cattle and capturing three of their shepherds, whilst the rest fled successfully. Those who fled went and informed the Banu Asad camp of the Muslim army's arrival and attack, and they described the numbers of Banu Salama's army to be very large. These shepherds greatly exaggerated by saying how large the army was, and this caused them to be even more fearful. And this struck even more fear into the Banu Asad tribe. They were so overcome with dread that they began to flee in fear in all directions. When Hazrat Abu Salama, may Allah be pleased with him, reached the camp of Banu Asad and saw that the enemy had fled, he sent his companions to search for them. Hazrat Abu Salama divided them into three groups. One remained with him, and the other two were sent in opposite directions, instructing them, "Do not go too far in pursuit of the enemy. And if you are not confronted by them, then return and spend the night here." He reiterated, "Do not split up, remain together." However, the enemies had run so fast whilst in a state of bewilderment that the Muslims were not confronted by any of them. Hazrat Abu Salama took all of the spoils of war and began his return journey to Medina. The guide who accompanied them also returned with them. After traveling for one night, Hazrat Abu Salama distributed the spoils of war. He put aside the khumus, that is one-fifth of the spoils of war, for the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, and gave the man who had helped them navigate an amount with which he was also happy, distributing the rest of the spoils of war amongst the remaining companions. Each companion received 7 camels along with a number of goats, and so after traversing a nearly 10-day journey, this group returned home happily to Medina. It is recorded about the demise of Hazrat Abu Salama, may Allah be pleased with him, what I've just stated just now, has been taken from various books of history. Some of it is also taken from the life and character of the Seal of Prophets. In any case, it is recorded about the demise of Hazrat Abu Salama that he stayed outside Medina for this expedition few more than 10 nights. When he returned home to Medina, the wound he had suffered at Uhud reopened, rendering him ill, and he passed away the same year on the 3rd of the month of Jumada al-Akhir. Tulayha bin Khuwaylid, the chief of the Banu Asad tribe mentioned earlier, was an extremely brave man, well known in the Arab Peninsula for being equal to 1,000 soldiers on horseback and famous for his eloquence. He joined Islam in the 9th century by presenting himself before the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, with a delegation of the Banu Asad tribe. However, he apostatized and in the lifetime of the Holy Prophet created disorder by falsely claiming to be a prophet. After failing at this, he eventually left Arabia. Then, after some time, he returned to Medina, re-entering Islam at the hands of Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, remaining steadfast in his faith in Islam until his dying breath. Having partaken with great bravery in the famous Battle of Qadisiyah in Persia and other Islamic battles, in the 21st year after the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon his migration, he was martyred fighting one of these battles. God Almighty desired for him to have a good end, and so eventually he was granted the ability to accept Islam. Then the expedition of Hazrat Abdullah bin Unais Juhani is mentioned. He was an ally to the Banu Salama tribe from among the Ansar. He partook in the second pledge of Aqaba, in the Battle of Badr, Uhud, and other battles. He was amongst those who had broken the idols of Banu Salama. He passed away in Syria during the 54th year after the Holy Prophet's migration, or in the 74th year according to other sources. When the people of various tribes surrounding Medina learned about what happened at the Battle of Uhud, amongst those who considered Islam to be weak and had planned to attack, when the chance arose, was the chief of the Banu Lahyan tribe, Khalid bin Sufyan Huzali Lahyani. According to some narrations, his name was Sufyan bin Khalid. Either way, he thought that since the Muslims still have fresh wounds from the Battle of Uhud, he would capitalize on their weakened state and attack them, looting and raiding Medina to impose his power. This person's heart dripped with malice towards Islam. He was also a very arrogant man. He was preparing an army near the valley of Nakhla Urifat, near Urana. He had begun rallying the soldiers of surrounding tribes to plot against the Muslims, and the people of various tribes had gathered around him for this purpose. When the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, learned that Sufyan bin Khalid was preparing an army against Medina, he opted for a uniquely strategic decision. Instead of sending an army which would have resulted in spilt blood on both sides. The Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, decided to target the man leading this army instead. Hence, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, selected his brave companion, Hazrat Abdullah bin Unais, for this important and dangerous mission. He called Abdullah bin Unais and told him all the details of Sufyan bin Khalid's plans. Instructing him to quietly go and assassinate him. Hazrat Abdullah said to the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, O Messenger of Allah, tell me how he looks. The Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, said, when you see him, fear will overcome you, and right when you see him, you will remember Satan. Hazrat Abdullah said, O Messenger of Allah, I have never feared anyone. Holy Prophet replied, yes, that is fine, but when you see him, you will get goosebumps. Thus, he departed alone on the 5th of Muharram, 4 after Hijrah, for this expedition. Hazrat Abdullah states, when I reached a place called Urana, which is a valley near Arafat, I saw Sufyan walking while holding a staff. Walking behind him were members of those tribes who were now affiliated with him. He wasn't using the staff because of old age, rather at that time it was a custom for people to keep a staff in their hands. Nonetheless, Hazrat Abdullah states, because of what the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, told me regarding him, I was able to immediately recognize him. Because right when I saw him, I was overcome with fear, even though I had never been afraid of anyone before. Thus I said in my heart, that Allah and His Messenger have told the truth. At that time, it was a time for the Asr prayer, which is why I was afraid that if I had to confront him, I didn't want to miss my Asr prayer. That is why I offered prayer in the condition that I was walking towards him. And alongside this, I would gesture my head, meaning he prayed by gesturing with his head. When I got close to him, he asked me who I was. I told him, I am from the Banu Khuza'a tribe. I heard that you are amassing an army against the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. Thus, I have come to join you as well. He replied, I am certainly amassing an army against Muhammad. Thus, I walked with him for some time. Then I began talking to him, and he took great interest in what I was saying. Sufyan bin Khalid said, actually, Muhammad has not seen anyone like me yet. Until now, he has only seen people who were not experts in warfare. Finally, when he reached his tent and those near him dispersed, he said to me, O Khuzai brother, come here please. When I came near him, he told me to sit down. I sat down near him to the extent that the quietness of night had descended and people fell asleep. I suddenly got up, killed him, and beheaded him. I left from that area and hid in a cave within the nearest mountain. While searching for me, people came all the way to the cave, but they didn't find anything. Thus, losing hope, those people went back. After this, I left the cave and set out. I would travel during the night and hide somewhere during the day. Eventually, I reached Medina, and upon seeing me, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, immediately stated, Aflah al-wajhu, meaning this face was successful. He, that is Hazrat Abdullah, very humbly and intelligently addressed the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, and quickly said, Aflah wajhuka ya Rasulullah, meaning your face is successful, O Messenger of Allah. Meaning this entire success is yours. It is a result of the blessings of your prayers. After this, Hazrat Abdullah gave all the details and placed the head of this rebellious leader in front of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. It is stated in another narration as well that the Holy Prophet gave the news about Sufyan bin Khalid before the arrival of Hazrat Abdullah bin Unais. Hazrat Abdullah states, joyful over this victory, The Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, gifted me a staff and said, "This will be the sign of heaven between you and me. You will use it for support in heaven." From then on, this staff always remained with Hazrat Abdullah bin Unais, to the extent that in his last moments, he addressed the members of his household for his will and said, "Put this staff in my clothing in such a way that it is between me and the clothing." Thus, the members of his house executed this will. Hazrat Abdullah bin Unais used to be called the one with the staff. Hazrat Abdullah bin Unais stayed outside Medina for a total of 18 days and returned on a Saturday when there were 7 days left of Muharram. Whilst detailing this expedition in the period of Muharram 5 after Hijrah, Hazrat Mirza Bashir Ahmad, may Allah be pleased with him, writes, "The incitement of the Quraysh and the temporary defeat of the Muslims at Uhud was now beginning to manifest its dangerous effects with great speed. As such, in the very same days when the Banu Asad was planning to raid Medina, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, received news that the people belonging to the tribe of Banu Lahyan were assembling a large army in their homeland, Orana, which is situated close to Makkah, upon the instigation of the chieftain Sufyan bin Khalid, and that their intent was to strike Medina. The Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, who was extremely wise and well aware of the condition of various Arabian tribes, and of the strength and influence of their chieftains, understood, as soon as this news was received, that this entire mischief and disturbance was the work of Sufyan bin Khalid, chief of the Banu Luhyan, and that if this person was removed from the equation, the Banu Luhyan could not dare to attack Medina. The Holy Prophet also knew that at present, except for Sufyan, there was no one else who possessed enough influence in this tribe to lead such a movement. Hence, taking into account that if a contingent was dispatched to resist the Banu Luhyan, not only would this cause the poor Muslims additional financial burden, but it was also likely that this course of action may open the door to further violence and bloodshed. Therefore, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, proposed that a single person should go and, upon finding an opportunity, execute Sufyan bin Khalid, the mastermind and root of this mischief. Hence, the Holy Prophet dispatched Abdullah bin Unais Ansari. And since Abdullah had never seen Sufyan before, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, personally described the figure of Sufyan, etc., to Abdullah. In the end, the Holy Prophet said, "Remain alert. Sufyan is an embodiment of Satan." As such, Abdullah bin Unais very skillfully reached the encampment of the Banu Luhyan, who were in fact diligently engaged in preparations to strike Medina, and found an opportunity at night and put an end to Sufyan. When the Banu Luhyan found out about this, they pursued Abdullah, but he managed to vanish undetected. When Abdullah bin Unais came before the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, the Holy Prophet immediately understood from the sight of his face that he had returned successfully. Hence, as soon as the Holy Prophet saw him, he said, "Aflah al-wajhu." "This countenance appears to be one of success." Abdullah responded, "And how beautifully indeed." "Aflah wajhuka ya Rasulullah." "O Messenger of Allah, all success belongs to you." At the time, the Holy Prophet endowed his staff to Abdullah as a reward and said, "This staff shall give you support in paradise." Abdullah safeguarded this blessed staff with immense love and sincerity, and upon his demise, asked for it to be buried with him. Thus, his wish was complied with accordingly. The joy which was expressed by the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, upon the successful return of Abdullah and the special reward which was granted to him, demonstrates that the Holy Prophet considered the sedition of Sufyan bin Khalid to be extremely dangerous and considers his execution to be a source of mercy for the public peace. Enemies of Islam allege that, God forbid, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, disrupted peace and shed human blood. The Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, valued human life so much that even to save the lives of people in enemy tribes, he proposed that it was better to forfeit one life so as to save all others. This is the pinnacle of human compassion. In today's so-called compassionate world, people kill many innocent children, women, and elders whilst targeting a select few. They confidently claim that such occurrences are to be expected in war. On the contrary, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, instructed during all wars that no child, woman, elderly, or religious clergy should be killed who are not directly involved in the war. Thus, this is the lofty example of Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, and the teachings of Islam. Now I will speak about the expedition of Raji. Because the account of this expedition is lengthy, I will only mention a few details today. This expedition is also known as the expedition of Marthad bin Abi Marthad, on account of it being led by Marthad bin Abi Marthad. However, it is more commonly referred to by the name of Raji'. Raji' was the name of a spring located in Hijaz that belonged to the Banu Huzail. Today, it is known as Bati'a and is located 70 kilometers north of Makkah. This expedition took place in Safar at the beginning of the year 4 after Hijrah at the Raji'. According to Ibn Ishaq and Ibn Hisham, this expedition took place 3 years after the Battle of Uhud. In the commentary of Sahih Bukhari, Sharh Fath al-Bari and Muwahib, it is reported to have taken place at the end of the 3rd year following the Battle of Uhud. Our research cell has provided a note about the expedition of the Raji', which may warrant looking into, because of the fact that there are varying dates. Nonetheless, this may be beneficial to researchers, hence I will read it. In the books of history, and even in Sahih al-Bukhari, the expedition of Raji' and the expedition of Bi'r Ma'una have been mixed up. Some biographers have pointed this out. Similarly, most biographers inadvertently write that the expedition of Raji' took place in Safar 4 after Hijrah. And in its details, they mention that during this expedition, Hazrat Khubayb and Hazrat Zayd were sold in Mecca. However, due to the start of the sacred months, the people of Mecca imprisoned them. And when the sacred months had passed, they killed both of them. Most biographers have stated this. However, when one carefully evaluates the matter, it becomes clear that there are 4 sacred months, 3 of which are consecutive, namely Dhul-Qa'dah, Dhul-Hijjah, and Muharram. Rajab comes 5 months after Muharram. If this expedition occurred in Safar, then 3 sacred months had passed before it, while the 4th sacred month was to come 4 months after Safar. Therefore, if it is to be accepted that this expedition took place in Safar 4 after Hijrah, it does not make any sense to also say that the sacred months had come. Furthermore, if they were not passing through the sacred months, then there was no reason to keep the 2 prisoners for so long. The people of Makkah were eager to kill them and satisfy the thirst for revenge. So what need did they have to imprison them for so long, during which they had to feed and protect them? The biographers who have stated that this event took place in Safar 4 after Hijrah have not raised these questions. There are 2 possibilities for us to consider. One is to accept that the matter of the sacred months and the imprisonment of the 2 companions for a period of time is incorrect. The second is that we deem all the narrations to be true and accept that they were passing through the sacred months during which they were imprisoned. Albeit, in this case, we must also accept that most historians and biographers were mistaken in preserving the history of this expedition, and we must agree with the very few that state that the 2 were sold in Makkah during the sacred months. That is, when Dhul-Qa'dah had begun, to be precise. Thus, whilst mentioning the accounts of the expedition of Raji', Ibn Ishaq, whose book is among the earliest biographers, and Ibn Hisham have both written that this expedition took place after the Battle of Uhud in 3 after Hijrah. Furthermore, Ibn Hajar has written in Fath al-Bari, the authentic commentary of Sahih al-Bukhari, that this incident took place at the end of 3 after Hijrah. Another reliable biography, Al-Mawahib al-Laduniyya, has also written the same. Thus, it seems most plausible that this expedition took place towards the last few days of Shawwal, 3 after Hijrah. Hazrat Khubayb and Hazrat Zayd were martyred in Safar 4 after Hijrah. When news of their martyrdom reached Medina over time, the narrations and history surrounding these incidents became more authentic. Nonetheless, Allah knows best. The background of this expedition is that in the previous incident, i.e., the expedition of Abdullah bin Unais, it was mentioned that the chief of Banu Lahyan, Sufyan bin Khalid, was killed, owing to which his tribe were thirsty for revenge. They would spend day and night forming plans of how to exact revenge against the Muslims. Hence, a few people from this tribe went to the Adal and Qara tribes. They were known for being skilled archers. The Adl tribe was a branch of the Banu Hawn bin Khuzaymah tribe, which is linked to Adl bin Daish. The Qara tribe is also a branch of the Hawn tribe and is associated with Daish. Banu Lahyan told them, "Go to Muhammad in Medina and tell him to send some of his companions with you to preach Islam to your tribe. It is very likely that he will send some of his companions with you. And when they come with you, we will seize them near Makkah and sell them. We will get a heavy price for it, and the Makkans can kill them. We will be able to exact our revenge, and from the wealth we gain, we will give you a portion thereof." Hence, with this planning in mind, 7 people from the Adl and Qara tribes came to Medina in the form of a delegation. They came to the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, and said, "Islam has gained great popularity among our tribe. Can you send some of your people with us who can preach the message of Islam?" During this time, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, had prepared a group of 10 companions who would go into the environs of Makkah on reconnaissance missions in order to gain information. When this delegation came, the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, sent off this same group of 10 with them. According to another narration, the Holy Prophet sent 7 companions along with them. Ibn Hisham has written that the Holy Prophet sent 6 companions with them, while Ibn Sa'd has written that they were 10 in total and has given the names of 7 people from among them. Sahih al-Bukhari also mentions 10 people, and the majority of the books on the biography of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, also mention 10 people. However, only the names of 7 companions are mentioned. The Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, appointed Ahsan bin Thabit as the leader of the delegation, and according to other narrations, he appointed Marthad bin Abi Marthad. As a Muslim, may Allah be pleased with him, states, "In the 4th year after Hijrah, as a migration, 2 Arab tribes, Adal and Qara, sent their representatives to the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, who mentioned that many people from their tribe were being inclined towards Islam, and requested for some people to be sent to them who were well versed in the Islamic teachings, so that they could live amongst them and teach them about this new faith. This, in fact, was a conspiracy which was hatched by the Banu Lahyan, who were bitter enemies of Islam. Their objective was to kill the delegation of the Muslims that would be accompanying them and thereby exact revenge for their leader, Sufyan bin Khalid. Thus, they sent these representatives of the Adl and Qara tribes to the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, in order to bring some of the Muslims back with them, and made great promises of reward to them. When the people of Adl and Qara went to the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, and put their request before him, the Holy Prophet took their word and sent 10 Muslims with them in order to teach them about the beliefs and principles of Islam. Subsequently, they went with them, and I will, inshallah, God willing, relate the incidents that followed. Today, again, I would like to remind you to especially pray for the Ahmadis who have been imprisoned in Yemen due to their faith, particularly the Sadr Lajna. She is being held in prison in very difficult circumstances, and a few others as well, who are not willing to give in to their demands. Especially pray for them that may Allah the Almighty procure the means for their release. Pray also for the Ahmadis imprisoned in Pakistan that they may be released. Continue praying for the Palestinians. When it seems that the conditions are improving, they end up taking a turn for the worse. The Israeli government is acting very stubbornly. May Allah the Almighty save the Palestinians from their cruelty, and may He enable the Muslims to play their role.
Alhamdulillah, na'amadu wa nasta'inuhu wa nasta'khfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shurur anfusina wa min sayyati amalina man yadihillahu falamudillalahu وَمَنْ يُضِلُّ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ وَنَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَنَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ إِبْعَادَ اللَّهِ رَحِمَكُمُ اللَّهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر.